Good evening, I guess. Today, I want to present some aspects of my ongoing PhD thesis, namely those aspects which specifically deal with computational mediated knowledge generation. I aim to show that the methodology of computational data analysis fits perfectly within a framework of archaeological reasoning, which already is applied by most archaeologists. Let's start with a brief introduction of the project. Since 2006, the German Archaeological Institute uses IDAField as its excavation database. IDAField is a relational database realized in FileMaker. At the moment, there are between 40 to 50 different projects using this database for their research data. From the beginning, it was the idea that if the projects enter their data in a database with a more or less standardized data model, later on a comparison and computational analysis of the data from these different excavations would not only be possible, but relatively easy in comparison to data which has to be integrated first. Yet until now, for various reasons, this had not happened. Also at the German Archaeological Institute, since 2013, there exists a research cluster connecting cultures, which aims to analyze different forms of cultural interactions in all their facets. Within one of its working groups, Mobility and Migration, three projects have been using IDAField as the excavation database. As you can see here, these projects are Selinunte, Taganrog, and Los Castillejos de Alcudin. The idea behind my PhD thesis is to combine now this archaeological research question of cultural context with a computational analysis of the data within those databases and to compare them with a very high resolution at the level of the record itself to see if there are some interesting patterns within the databases not yet discovered, which could be used to shed more light on this complex question of cultural context. To be clear here, my work is mainly a method-critical approach which aims to evaluate benefits gained from data mining techniques within a framework of archaeological reasoning. Also, I try to avoid most of the issues related to data integration with the use of databases which are already in IDAField with theoretically a consistent scheme. There are unfortunately still many problems within the data that have to be addressed. Just as a little overview here, we're dealing with about 115,000 records. Most of them are finds, and most of the finds, of course, are ceramics. But actually, not all of IDAField's instances have the same structure. There are different projects with very different requirements, and the solution has been to use models for certain functionality. Sometimes some tables in different databases, the same tables in different databases have a different number of columns as well due to later alterations. Many of the inconsistencies can be traced back to decisions made in the database design phase, especially during the user interface design process, where the creativity of the later users has been highly underestimated, I guess. The biggest issue here is, and by far the biggest issue here is that most of the fields are free text fields, and they have been used very inconsistently. Unfortunately, that is in German, but I can assure you that there are uncountable different ways to describe black gazed attic ware within the database. There are a lot of synonyms. There is no consistency of terminological use within the databases and among them. Also, in some of the databases, different languages are used all at once. Some fields are used for different purposes, like here, for example, where you find the information of a reuse, here in German again, but I will translate, the information of reuse of this shared in a field dedicated to its form. Basically, you need a lot of natural language processing to make sense of this data. Another point is that often the databases are not used as the only source of truth, so you also have some inconsistencies with the later publications. As you can see, for example, here, where in the database is noted that, that its object comes from Millet, while in the later publication, I translated it here. Okay, it's noted that it comes from the South Union area. And you don't have any possibility to check if this is the suit to a later change in interpretation or suit to an error made of the person who interpreted or her, got this information out of the database. Besides these problems, which belong mainly to the scope of data cleaning and integration, there are others with more epistemic consequences. I will just mention some of them. We already know that due to taphonomic processes and sampling bias, etc., there are a lot of structural biases in archaeological data. But also, some new kind of biases are introduced by the data model itself. For example, category bias, as described by González Pérez in 2012, as a forced accommodation of reality when researchers have to enter their data into categories which do not fit the data well. And here we are again at the question of how to separate data from interpretation, which I will not discuss here further, but it's quite an interesting topic. Also, you have to deal with uncertainty, with many kinds of uncertainty, in fact, spatial, chronological, etc. Mostly, you are dealing with uncertainty not in a statistical sense, but in a more informal way. So you, it's quite difficult to formalize and quantify those uncertainties. There are some solutions, I just mentioned, for example, fuzzy logic and fuzzy sets or Bayes statistics together with radiocarbon dating, but none of them are perfect. And the important part is all of them require a lot of decisions to be made, which have later be recognizable. There's also the question of resolution on scale, highly related. The point is to find the right resolution for an analyst at a given scale. But also how to define the objects of interest itself, for example, bones versus shirts or vessels versus individuals, or can I use the volume of the artifacts? Finally, there are a lot of choices which have to be made regarding the actual algorithms itself. These choices concern all of the four main categories of algorithms you normally use for data analysis-related tasks. For example, these algorithms have very different requirements regarding the type and shape of the data. Relevant features have to be selected. Seldom using all features yields a good result, or it's even possible. Most of the algorithms require a variety of parameters to be chosen. Often, just experience and exploration gets the right results. And many of these algorithms work in a rather obscure way, which make it hard to understand what exactly the results are coming from. I will stop my enumeration of problems here. We have seen that there are many problems with the data, despite of its alleged standardized data model. Some of those can be addressed during the design of the data model or the database itself. Some others, like, for example, the category bias problem, not so easily. There are a number of problems arising of the fractured nature of the archaeological record and the question how to translate those into a formalized scheme without multiplying or occulting them. Also, some new problems related to the algorithms itself are introduced. In the end, those factors affect the explanation, and the archaeologist has to evaluate them alongside the results of the analysis, the patterns discovered. Therefore, the challenge is to enable the archaeologist, I think, to review all those decisions and factors who affect the analysis. This is not an easy task, but not unresolvable either. An especially promising approach in this direction is an exploratory data analysis through visualization. Visualization has many advantages, and I can't discuss them all here. It is especially useful in combination with interaction to understand the data, but also the actual effects algorithms and the parameter choices have on the resulting pattern. I just want to show this great example here, I think it's from last West conference last year, called Cluster Vision. And this is a perfect example where you can see what effect do the different parameter choices have on the clustering, and the which effects do the single features have on the clustering as well. I think this is quite a good example on how to get an insight in the working of the algorithm and your data as well. In this way, you can frame most of these problems as the questions of how these problems affect the reliability of your data, and reduce them therefore to the well-known problem in archaeology, to the problem of source criticism. I make that very short. Then computational analysis of archaeological data fits perfectly well within a framework of archaeological reasoning known as abduction, with a well-known structure I have put on here. It is a very controversial topic, and we don't have the time to discuss this further. But I want to say I favor an interpretation of abduction, which is recently proposed by Schwartz, which is now closer to the original idea of Pierce than most of the modern uses. This interpretation has an emphasis on abduction as a tool in the context of hypothesis discovery and not just in the context of justification of the knowledge. And it is within this evaluation of the different hypotheses where the real power of computational analytics and visualization comes into play, where you can explore and test a wide variety of hypotheses against each other quite easily. And I want to skip to the end directly. No, I want, it's gone. Okay. Then I don't have the nice quote from Clark. Okay, but I wanted to show with this quote, which has unfortunately vanished from my presentation, that that it's important to regard this analytical process not as a process which finished after the analysis. It's a process which can change with new data, with new results, with other interpretations from other archaeologists, and you have to account for this in a way that you make all your results explorable for other archaeologists, and I'm a little bit off the missing slide. To make them explorable for all other archaeologists, and to account for this also in the publication. Publication should not be a static type of publication where you just present your data. You have to present also your reasoning, and with the help of computational tools, you can do this also in an interactive way, where you give the readers of your text the possibility to interact with the data and to change the different parameters of the algorithms. Okay, that's it.